And so I'd like to wait. We have two fantastic celebrities here from Red Hat, Threebean and MikeB. we'd like to welcome you. I'm obviously between two beards. And they have two fabulous faces of hair. Like, I mean, it is wonderful. And before we get into talking about continuous improvement, let's find out a bit about each of them. First, thanks, Ralph. I know that you normally shave your beard off at around this time of year. And I'm so thankful that you've kept it for this event. So, but why do you shave it off in the middle of winter instead of summer? That seems crazy.
That's kind of personal, Neil. You know, I actually stopped. I decided to stop doing that.
Oh, okay. So you're keeping the beard.
Yeah, it's because you kept insulting me about it. So.
Well, you are too beautiful without your beard. I don't know if anyone's seen him. He is very beautiful. And Mike B., you have any great beard trip tips for people?
I do. Beard balm, never leave home without it. I take it wherever I go. Add a little on there, gives it a nice sheen. Highly recommended.
Excellent. And
you might want some Miracle-Gro and some Rogaine.
And the top of my head, too, yes. So both of you have hardcore rap names, Mike B, Threebean. Who's your favorite hip-hop group? And give us an interesting backstory about why you have this cool name.
I don't know. A Tribe Called Quest. Very, 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 very good. Yeah. Or maybe you. I don't know. Do you rap?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
And
yeah.
My
nickname. So Threebean, it actually comes from my name. People think it's because I had a kid, and there'd be three people in my family, but I'm Ralph Bean the third, so it's Threebean. It's not. Yeah.
And your name is boring. I'm just not going to really ask you about it. And so, Ralph, I heard you have many cats. How many cats are in your beard right now? And do you hate dogs? Oh, well, that's what's going around. Mike B., I heard you are an interesting scuba. You have scuba stuff?
I do.
Yeah, and do you keep your snorkel in your beard?
Sometimes, but not right now.
Okay. And what's your favorite fish?
I guess it would probably have to be the humu humu nuku nuku apua'a, because it's fun to say.
Wow, I didn't expect that. Down to business. Okay, you guys are both part of the amazing Factory 2.0 team, which, despite your involvement, has become highly functional. They work with consistent goals of self-improvement. And Mike, can you give us a rundown of the history of Factory 2.0 and the products you've created?
Yeah, the Factory 2 initiative started way back in the day from a conversation with some executives, and they said, we don't like the way the pipeline works, so we want you to fix it. It was literally the only instructions that I got. So we started trying to figure out, well, what the problems actually were, actually did a survey of stakeholders. Ralph was involved in that. We took the survey results, had them vote on the highest priority ones. We got a list of about seven priorities out of that, and then just decided to figure out how to start addressing them.
And some people aren't from Red Hat, so maybe tell them, what does Factory 2.0 trying to do?
So the basic concept is improving the product pipeline. We've heard a lot this weekend probably about like monolithic applications that people are dealing with, so we're no different. Applications that have developed over the course of a decade or more, so we're breaking those down into microservices, applying some modern development and deployment processes to services in the pipeline, and using that to accelerate delivery of new features and enabling us to innovate more in response to the business.
Cool. And what are all the products that we now have? I have a T-shirt with a bunch of them, but
I have the same T-shirt.
Oh, excellent!
We could just walk you through the T-shirt.
Okay.
So ResultsDB is very much as it sounds. It's a database to store test results and centralize them, provide an API to query them. FreshMaker is a service which responds to events from other services and triggers other events. So we use that for automating things like rebuilds. GreenWave is a policy engine. In fact, it was originally named Policy Engine until we got told that wasn't interesting enough. and it tells you when a set of criteria for releasing something has been met. And then on-demand compose service, also somewhat self-explanatory, but it runs composes on demand.
Okay, I'll have to go back to my screen soon. Okay, so cool. And Sophie's choice, Ralph, if you could only save one product of all the products that the team has made, which one are you going to change?
I can't answer that.
Yes, you can.
I can?
Yeah.
Greenwave. I have to? It's Greenwave, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, it's Greenwave, yeah.
And you?
I'll say ResultsDB, because it's like the beginning of the start of it all.
Okay, I might have to log back in. Sorry about the mic. Okay, surprisingly, some people actually use your products. And so here's a slide of people saying wonderful things about them. And I don't know if Josh is here, but Josh doesn't look like that at all. I think that's his Tinder picture. Like, I mean, where do these people get these pictures? Okay, now, What we're going to talk about next is actually about continuous improvement and what we did with our team. So first of all, to get your team to have a continuous improvement mindset, they have to be a team. And so Mike, how did the team start though?
So the team really just started with me and Ralph, and we came up with a plan and proposed that to stakeholders, and they agreed. And then we said, okay, we're going to need some people. So we just started borrowing people from other parts of the organization, and we got some people from DevOps who were involved, and explain the concept and the approach that we were taking to them, and launch some new projects. Actually, I should step back a little bit. The first thing we said was, well, what can we repurpose that already exists to help us achieve our goals? And so one of the first steps was bringing in some of the pieces that already existed in Fedora, like ResultsDB. That was a component that had already been used in Fedora as part of the Taskatron project. And we redeployed it internally and said, you know, this was going to be how we're aggregating test content. So how do we like move on from there and build on that? And then figured out some new services that we needed to develop, started a design process, and continue from there.
And when I entered the team, you guys were developing using Scrum. And then we quickly moved to doing Kanban. And I said some stuff all the time. And do you guys repeat after me? Same sized work. If you're doing Kanban, everything has to be the same sized, or else you'll fail. And so, but in order for our team to be thinking about continuous improvement, we took some steps to make them feel like they were a team. So we worked on, and we had goals of having them feel connected. We had a goal of having it being fun to be on our team. And we had a goal of them being technically challenged on our team. Okay, so Mike, do you want to talk about some strategies we use to help people connect?
Yeah, we were always a distributed team. It was sort of the nature of you finding resources where they were available. So we would... We had video conferences, as most distributed teams do. We encourage people to, you know, actually be present, turn on their cameras. We would do various things to make sure that people understood what we were trying to accomplish and what value we were bringing as part of our efforts. I think it's really important so that people feel the value of the work that they're doing. We made sure that the team understood who the stakeholders were. What they were trying to achieve with every sprint, and then we had longer term quarterly milestones about actually delivering.
Don't go there yet.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
But we think about the retros. We changed retros, switching times.
Yeah, so we would go back and forth between different time zones. That was another challenge with distributed teams, is that we had people in Australia, in Brno, in Beijing, East Coast, West Coast of the U.S. So time zones were a challenge, and so we would try to spread the pain out and switch when we did retros, so that everybody could be inconvenienced equally.
And you guys worked hard at getting it face-to-face on occasion as well.
Yep, we did face-to-faces whenever budget allowed. We did a big one associated with Flock when it was in Hyannis, Massachusetts. Some of you may have been there. And that was really great. It's really valuable, even though you might see people on a stand-up or a retro every, you know, every few days or every week. Getting people together in a room and being able to talk and have really high bandwidth conversations was very valuable.
Thanks. And then Ralph, although you are fun challenged, you wanted the team to have fun at work. So what are some of those things that we tried out to make that happen?
Yeah, so I'm not fun challenged in general. It's just the mandatory organized fun that I'm a little resistant to. But we did do some cool things. One of them was we had a funny hats challenge week. So like stand up was getting a little dry. We were doing the same things over again. So we said wear a funny hat to stand up, but on a surprise day. And so people would start stand up with their, you know, turn their cameras on and we'd have a good chuckle at the beginning of stand up. I think you won that, Neil.
Yes.
Yeah. This tremendous hat covered in owls. It was like a Dr. Seuss hat. We did another thing where we did a team trivia. You know, we work a lot with each other and we understand each other's technical preferences and what we're focused on. But we would we had people submit questions and answers about themselves and then assembled it in this big maybe 20 question survey that we put around the team. You know, who's the member of the team that has this one attribute or another? And then we reviewed them in our retro. We just basically scrapped retro for the whole sprint that week, and then just like one by one systematically unveiled the answers with people guessing and betting on who was who in the team. And it was cool. We got to, you know, learn things about each other and get that background. So, yeah.
I think Mike, you had shoes that melted in a volcano. Was that right?
I did, in fact.
And Mike, you like to be challenged yourself technically by waking up and turning a computer on. But in terms of people that actually do work on the team, how do you keep them challenged?
So we have a lot of different areas of work that we're involved in. So we would pretty likely just ask people, like, which one of these services do you know the most about? Which do you know the least about? What are you most interested in learning more about? So just being engaged with the team and understanding what their interests are and where they feel like they could grow. We also created a apprenticeship program so that people who were more familiar with the code base could mentor people on who are less familiar with it, and bring them up to speed, which was great for not only reducing the bus factor, but also getting people involved in code bases that they weren't familiar with and spreading the expertise across the entire team. So not having people be siloed in one code base or one particular area of the pipeline.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool program. We had and we started it with a survey so that people volunteered for getting into products that they weren't able to get into, and we had we had people volunteer. And it seems, again, it challenges them technically. We also do surveys quarterly to see if people are satisfied with the work they're doing to make sure that they still want to be part of the team, right? Because we don't want them to be leaving. Okay, so we worked on becoming a team. That's really important. And the next thing we worked on was what is our vision? So you can't get somewhere if you don't know where you want to go. And MikeB, you were responsible for coming up with some of our vision. Our secret vision of having three cats live in your beard has worked out. But what is the factory vision?
I touched on it a little bit earlier, but the overall vision is really to move what had been a pretty legacy style pipeline into more modern best practices of software engineering deployment. So, you know, using microservices, moving toward continuous deployment, continuous integration across all of our services, and using that as an enabler to be more reactive and responsive to the constantly changing needs of the stakeholders and the business.
Cool. And so we have this overall vision of
how Factory 2.0 is going to transform our pipeline. And then we also have something we call OKRs, or on our team we call them original crazy wraps. And so, Ralph, you, what were some good or bad wraps that we've used? You might really want to tell people what they are.
They weren't wraps. OKRs, the objectives and key results. And so this was a way that we ended up trying to keep the team focused and have a direction and have something that was also measurable, and we would know whether or not we were making progress towards it. And so in the beginning, it didn't really work out well. We took what were our epics in Jira, the major chunks of work that we were working on. And so one of the tools we were is on the shirt is FreshMaker, and we had a big FreshMaker epic in the beginning. But the thing is as work continued and as we got new information and new feature requests coming in, that epic just continued to grow and grow and grow, and there was no point when it would ever be done. So that was about the point in time when we stopped and said we need something that is measurable and that's going to have an end. And so we established some OKRs, like we need this feature set to be delivered by this point in time. But it ended up being like abstract and disconnected from what the team was doing. And things really transformed when we took the OKRs from just like a kind of project management level and brought it down into the team and like started assessing on a week-to-week basis in stand-up, like how are we at moving towards this particular goal at times less than just focusing on all the new cards that are coming in and all the new cards that we're working on. We ended up doing some process improvement OKRs there in the mix too. So like some were feature driven. We want people who use the pipeline to be able to do this new thing. And then other OKRs would be like, we want to change the amount of time that it takes us to get through code reviews to reduce that by, we'll say, 10% in this quarter over the previous quarter. And those too, when we would just keep them at a tracking level and we weren't talking about them in the team, proved to be of no value. But it's only when you bring them in and work with the team to talk about them on a regular basis that they tend to have that feedback loop.
Yeah, and I think this is a bit of the secret sauce for how the team has helped keep vision, keep focused and work on things, was how they tie every quarter the work that they're doing to something and change it and work together on what that is. And when you pull work, you know that it comes from, like it's attached to the epic that you're supposed to be working on, sort of thing, right? Okay, we only have 5 minutes left. So, Mike, you're going to talk about how we use how OKRs, although help prioritize the backlog, though.
Sure. When we started thinking about OKRs, we really wanted to make sure that we were tracking things that were visible to customers, so that we're actually making a measurable impact to the people that were using the pipeline. So, you know, internal engineering, QE, people that engage with the pipeline. So, that would help us, you know, focus on what were the important things that we had to work on, right? We, like every team, right, we have a ridiculous amount of requests that come in from all sources, even things that we want to fix, you know, technical debt. Bugs with the services, requests for new features, and you know that all gets into if that's all just piled up in a backlog, it can be pretty daunting to figure out what you should actually be working on next. So, when in the context of OKRs, we were able to think about what are those things in backlog that are actually the most painful or like the most pressing for our customers and our stakeholders, and then organize those into larger pieces of work that we could then address over the course of, you know, a month or a quarter. And deliver and show real value to the stakeholders. So that was helpful.
Yeah. Again, I think one of the big secret sauces. And so we have a team. Feel like a team. We have set up some crazy wraps, and now we are doing some experiments and seeing if they're working. And especially with process changes. So we were doing Kanban, and we analyze our flow. And we monitor our queue sizes, our WIP, and our throughput and cycle times. If you want to find out what those things are and what those mean, talk to me afterwards. But basically, it allows us to see our work. And we really watch where our inventory builds up and look for where we're having problems, where that's happening. And we had a great thing where we were watching this. So, Ralph, if you want to talk about the deployment WIP breakage and then what we did about that.
Yeah. So as a development team, primarily a development team, we have some tickets, and when you work on a ticket, it moves through various phases. You go to in progress, you do some code review, and as a development team, after code review, you're done, right? You close the ticket because it's done. But for us as a DevOps team, that's not true. It actually has to make it into production. And for our team in particular, it's even a little bit more complicated because we were developing services that we wanted to deploy to the Fedora production environment for Fedora's use cases, and also to the internal production environment to produce Red Hat products. And so it ended up being this sizable chunk of work for us. Deployment is always work, but for us it was double because we had to do it twice. And it was this hidden work. We were thinking, we're working on these cards, why aren't we making any progress on our development cards? Oh, it's because everybody is drowning in deployment times. So we changed the way we did Kanban and added new columns on the side for that a card isn't actually done until it's deployed in production in both circumstances. And what we knew to be true already, kind of intuitively, that we have a whole bunch of deployment stuff going on, we could see visibly on our board. So when we get to stand up and there's some cards in progress and there's like 25 cards pending deployment, we're like, why spend any more time adding new cards through code review and getting them into the queue when we just need to get this stuff deployed to get it out? And making that work visible as a part of the tool that the team used to talk about their work every day was key. You know, if just you or I was monitoring it, it wouldn't make a difference.
Yeah, and we definitely saw an improvement from, I think, 20 days to get stuff deployed to about 10 days or less now, right? Oh, 5 days now. Wow. Amazing. So that's it. I don't know if we might have time for a question, but we have 1 minute left. So thanks, everybody, for coming, and thanks for the beards for putting up with my jokes. And I hope you had a good time. Any questions? Okay, thank you.